Yeah, we're live.
Good evening, everyone. A warm welcome to everyone present here. Thank you for taking a moment and your presence for our event. Today, we are having our extremely talented champions from grade 8 for fulfilling their social responsibility by expressing the concerns and coming up with innovative ideas. Our students will be witnessing space pollution. Without much further delay, I would like to invite Group 1.
So, hi guys, this is me, Hansika TG from Naranai Techno School, Ballari. A very warm good afternoon to everyone present here, respected teachers and my dear friends. So, we are here to present our hard work which we had spent all the way in the research of space pollution. Space pollution. It has caused a mess out of our mind. So let us see what the mess it has caused, but not in our minds, but in the space. So before that, I gradually thanks to all the teachers who had supported us a lot. A thanks to Shabrinath sir, Sharon ma'am, Purva ma'am, and Deepika ma'am for their huge support. And a big hand in this project is my teammates. I thank Laksh, Pranav, Shreya, and Rahul for their support. So what we are going to discuss now, we are going to know what is space pollution, means the introduction to that, and the types of space pollution and few causes, and let us study a case and even some references.
Good evening to one and all present here. So space pollution, you guys have heard about some cases on space pollution, some projects on space pollution, and many more topics. But have you heard a poem on space pollution? Wondering, right? So there's an amazing space poem on space pollution, which is written by S. Tai Nguyen on Scott. So I'm going to recite that poem for you. The universe is infinite, but space has its limits. Rockets are launching, satellites are orbiting. Explosions in the space, oh, what a waste. Fragments go flying and we go crying. Space junk we've got, man-made or not. Then comes Skelter, who knows that better. When things collide, the debris do multiply. Thanks to partnering and NASA's gathering, we look for ways to manage the space. So the next interesting topic which we're going to move on is introduction to space pollution. So you guys have heard about land pollution, air pollution, and water pollution. But have you heard about space pollution? But how are these caused? So water pollution is caused by throwing junk and garbage into the water, and air pollution is caused by burning of crackers and smoke from factories and vehicles, and the land pollution is caused by littering the land without using dustbins. But how is this space pollution caused? This space pollution, so we need some information. So like, how does the earth look from the space? What is the diameter between the Mercury and Venus? To collect all this information, we need rockets and satellites. So we send some satellites to get the information. So when we get this information, we can't get the satellites back. So they remain in the space itself. So, and then these
Yes, continue Shreya. Our slide needs to be changed.
These can collide into some space debris or meteorites and be a part of space pollution. These are also, space pollution is also called as space debris, space junk, space garbage, and these are no use for us. So these include non-functional spacecraft, mission-related debris, unburned particles, solid rocket motors, and many more. Space debris represent a risk to spacecraft. How? So when we launch new satellites or space rockets, they can also crash into these space debris and they also can break up into small pieces and can be a part of space pollution. In the year 2019, the US Space Surveillance Network had a report that there were 20,000 artificial objects which were orbiting above the Earth. However, this was so much thing to be orbited, so much thing to be tracked and informed.
So we have seen a poem and the introduction to space pollution. Now let us see the types of space pollution. So there are two types of space debris, which is artificial space debris and natural space debris. So let us go deeper in that.
So everyone, so now we have came to know about space pollution and its types. So now let us see one of its types. So that is artificial space debris. So artificial space debris is any non-functional man-made object in space. It is mainly caused because of us, because we send satellites to space. So when these satellites have reached an end to their life or have lost fuel or power, they become debris. So the first artificial space debris was from the Sputnik 1, which was launched on 4th October 1957. It remained in the orbit for more than 10 years. So it mainly consists of fragments from exploding of batteries, fuel tanks, and various parts of the spacecraft. So one of the main reasons behind artificial space debris is that it is mainly caused due to the collision of satellites and spacecrafts. And another main reason is that it is caused from the nose cones, payload covers, shrouds, bolts, and many other parts of the spacecraft. So these contribute to this artificial space debris. So the oldest ever artificial space debris is a piece of American Vanguard, which was launched in 1958. So we can call artificial debris as orbital debris. So this is because most artificial space debris orbit around the Earth. So I'll say you an interesting fact, that is that 20,000 artificial debris are orbiting around the Earth with a high speed of 17,500 meter per hour.
Good evening to all. You might be knowing about artificial space debris, but do you know what is natural space debris? Today I'm going to tell you about that. Natural space debris is something that's caused by the nature and not by human beings, and these are debris mostly orbit around the sun, and it is not caused due to the human resources at all, because as it's caused by the nature, and it can even cause a damage to satellites as it comes at the speed of 23,500 kilometers per hour. And if it hits the satellite, it can the satellite can lose the connectivity from the Earth, and it can even cause damages to the Earth surface.
So now we have come to know about its space pollution types and its definition. So let us see what are its causes. So one of the main causes behind the artificial space pollution is that because we are launching unnecessary items from the Earth to the space. So these remains in the atmosphere. These remain in the space for more than a lifetime. So it re-enters the atmosphere in meteoroids. So at present, since 1957, there were more than 5,000 rocket launches took place around the world. So another main reason behind space pollution is that some space junk results from collision of two satellites. For example, when two satellites collide, they break up into many pieces, creating a lot of new debris. So this is rare, but countries like USA, China, and US and India, which are well known space agencies like India ISRO and USA NASA, they have practiced blowing up their own satellites using missiles. So it's even caused when astronauts accidentally drop things in space.
Our space age was started at 1957, and the first satellite that was launched was Sputnik 1, and it was launched in 1957. And there are 2,000 satellites in the Earth's orbit right now, and from which 3,000 are dead satellites. And from a total of 34,000 pieces of space junk are larger than 10 centimeters. And 128 million pieces of space junk is larger than 1 millimeter. And 1 in 10,000 have a risk of collision, which requires debris avoidance maneuvers. And since 1999, ISS avoided 25 space debris.
And now we are going to see the case study. So the first case is the US commercial satellite was owned by Gideon, which was launched in 1997, weighted 560 kgs. different Russian satellite launched in 1993 was weighted nearly 1 ton. When these two satellites collided in space at the high speed of 800 km above Siberia, smashed apart into many pieces. Now the second case is on the 27th April 2000, around 15:30 South African Standard Time, three pieces of space debris impacted three separate locations in the Western Cape. Out of three pieces, one was the large cylindrical stainless steel tank fell on a dairy farm, and the second was a titanium spear which fell on a vineyard farm. The third was a conical section of a combustion chamber exhaust nozzle. Later, it was confirmed that it was the parts of a Delta II rocket stage.
Group 2.
Group 2, just raise your hands one by one as order.
Vinmai, I have unmuted you.
Yes, ma'am. Can we start, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am. Hello, everyone. Good evening to all of you. As you have already seen what is space pollution and the cause of space pollution, we are now going to explain you on the harmful effects of space pollution.
The students who participated in this project are Reddy Sri Sai Maurya, Vannay Manjanath, Janavi N, Shanmukh Metla, Pranav Krishna C.
From more than 40 countries, about 8,900 satellites have been launched, and in that, there are many dead satellites in space. According to 2018, some 5,000 satellites remain in the orbit, and about 1,900 were operational, and the rest lived their useful lives, and they became the space debris. People captured many footage of the burning up debris over the past few months in our atmosphere. According to the ESA, that is European Space Agencies, they estimate that there are about 23,000 objects, roughly 5,000 launches, and 65% of the objects have been catalogued, and in a result of 250 breakups in orbit and about 10 collisions. And they think that if there is a collision at speed of 10 km per second in the lower orbit, that is anything larger than 10 cm, then it is called catastrophic. In catastrophic space means catastrophic is the destruction of your spacecraft. About 20% of the objects are satellites and 17% are used as rocket bodies and the other objects from space missions. The reminder is that debris from fragmentation. The truth is there has been lot of junk up there for long time and so far, and no one has been hurt here on Earth till now. The first satellite went into the orbit, the Soviet Union Sputnik. It was launched on October 4, 1957. It steadily increased the number of objects encircling a planet. And when you speak of space debris, it's not only just satellite. Agencies are specially referring to inactive human-made objects that orbit the Earth.
On board the International Space Station in 2013, Canadian astronaut Chris Hadfield noticed a small hole on one of the solar arrays. Now, you might be wondering, space pollution is a problem, then why isn't NASA, ISRO, ESA or other space agencies working on it? I'll just give you an example. The plastic problem which we are now seeing on our Earth or a global scale, and now we are seeing that the plastic is being reduced from our oceans and our day-to-day lives. In space, we are a little slow on the uptake, but not only finding the solution stops the problem, even implementing it. And fortunately, at the moment, space junk doesn't pose a risk to our exploration efforts. It only poses a risk to the other satellites in its orbit. I'm going to tell you even about the Kessler syndrome. Kessler syndrome is a theory proposed by NASA scientist Donald J. Kessler in the year 1978. This theory said that when one satellite or debris collides with another, it creates more debris. And if any action is not taken against this debris, then it would be a reason for more inevitable collisions. This theory also said that we are launching too many satellites and rocket bodies into the low Earth orbit by creating a very dense environment around that orbit. For the future generations, crossing that orbit would be a pretty tough task. And as a probability of the rising object count, the probability of the collisions will also grow.
Interesting event happened on January 22nd of 2013 when the Russian satellite BLITS had a sudden change in its orbit and its spin. This left the Russian scientists confused and they decided to abandon the mission. It was believed that the sudden change was due to the collision between the BLITS and the debris of Fengyang-1C. Now you may ask, what is the Fengyang-1C debris? And well, that's a good question. The Fengyang-1C was a weather satellite. It collided with an anti-satellite during a test of an anti-satellite system. This collision made up more than 20% of the debris in space. That is, it created more than 3,000 fragments. It was not only the Fengyang-1C which caused these debris to increase. The Iridium and Cosmos 2251, along with the Fengyang-1C, make up one half of the debris in the atmosphere within 1,000 kilometers.
As we can see in the below graph, this graph is led to catalytic objects in different countries. In almost 6 years of space activities, more than 5,250 launches have resulted in some 40,000 tracked objects in orbit, of which about 22,000 remain in space and are regularly tracked by US Space Surveillance Network and maintained in the catalog, which covers objects less than about 5 to 10 centimeters in low Earth orbit. About 24% of catalog objects are satellites, less than a third of which are operational. About 18% are upper stages and mission-related objects such as launch adapters and lens covers. More than 290 in-orbit fragmentation events have been recorded since 1961. Only a few were collisions, fewer than 10 accidental international events. The majority of events were explosions in spacecraft and upper stages. Satellites launched into lower Earth orbit are continuously exposed to aerodynamic forces on the tenuous upper reaches of the Earth's atmosphere. Depending on altitudes, after a few weeks, years, or even this resistance decreases the satellite's efficiency, so it re-enters the atmosphere at high altitudes, above 800 km. Air drag becomes less effective and objects will generally remain in orbit for many decades.
Another mysterious event happened on February 10th of 2009. An inactive satellite collided with an active satellite. They were both communication satellites. They were operated by the US and the Russian military. They were the Cosmos 2251 and the Iridium 33. This collision took place about 800 kilometers above Siberia and it formed around 2,000 pieces of debris, measuring about 10 centimeters in diameter. These debris would remain in the space for decades or longer. This will be a risk to other objects in the low Earth orbit. Now, the Cosmos 2251 and the Iridium 33 were the first ever satellites to ever collide. According to the procedures, any one of the military should have issued a warning before the collision. Now, you must be wondering, why was a warning not issued before the collision took place? The answer is, in neither of their screenings, the satellites appeared. Although both the US and the Russian military have an accurate tracking data system, when reviewed again, both the satellites were not seen. Since this collision, the US has taken measures to do daily screenings and to observe any close approaches and inform the satellite operators of potential collisions.
Space junk can alter the satellite movement. My example are CZ-4C rocket and Soviet Para 64. Stages were tooted. They were going to collide, but thankfully they did not. After launch, the spent rocket bodies get unglued. They can cross flight paths and they may collide with one another. It is known when unspent fuel is on board, it may explode. But in today's world, this is relatively low. This is the table of fragmentation debris. Conclusion. The generation of space debris entails numerous harmful effects. Besides the damage potential induced through in-orbit collision and re-entry hazards, the pollution of outer space represents a significant challenge of the long-term usability of outer space. As a result of rising object count, the probability of collision will also grow. Even the smallest object in space can ruin a well-running satellite.
Group 3, please raise hands. Tanushree, I have unmuted you.
Yes, ma'am. Be a part of solution, not a part of pollution. Good evening to one and all present here. Myself, Tanushree from BLR VRP branch. I would like to introduce my teammates, Arnav, Pravanya, J.N. Mohan Krishna, Tyagarajan, Rohit, Amulya, Karunya, and myself. Wait! Let me take you in the world of space pollution. You all are very much eager to know about it. Am I right? We all know what is space pollution. What are the causes of space pollution? How does space pollution occur? And what are the deadly incidents that took place because of space pollution? Here are some creative solutions for clearing up space junk.
Yes. Now I'm going to say some creative implementation ideas for cleaning up space junks. Number one, giant lasers, working off laser beam. Laser orbital debris removal, LODR, uses the pulse ground-based laser to shoot the junk. LODR, that is laser orbital debris removal, is the best method for cleaning both big and small debris. Okay, now LODR, that is, by using high-powered pulse lasers, which will be situated on the Earth, will shoot plasma jets to the space to either burn up the junk or fall into the oceans. The debris which are falling into the oceans can be recycled. This method is called laser orbital debris removal. Structure of the giant laser. The structure of the giant laser includes LIDAR receiver camera, cryocooler, which is also known as expander tip, propellant tanks, power, a processor, batteries, primary structure, which is present in the bottom of the machine, propulsion, LIDAR laser transmitter for transmitting the laser, UV visible camera for tracking of the space debris, and IMU. Now you all will be worrying, what is the budget of the machine? As the economic condition of ISRO is economically backward compared to NASA. Now, the main thing for this machine is budget. Come, now let's look the budget of the machine. The 5 kW laser would cost about rupees 6 crores and a single device could probably engage about 10 objects a day. The government has allocated rupees 30,000 crores for the Indian Space Research Organization, known as ISRO, for the next financial year, where revenue for the Department of Space is estimated a little more than 6,000 crores. The government has proposed a capital allocation of nearly 8,000 crores in the budget. By using this budget, we can propose this project as a very easy and affordable one, as it is the easiest method to clean up space junks.
We all might have been wondering what may be the result of laser beam. The result of laser beam is high-powered pulse lasers are going to be situated on the Earth, which will shoot plasma jets into the space. Plasma jets can travel 75 kilojoules per meter square during a 5-nanosecond pulse. Plasma jets into the space could burn up space debris in the atmosphere or let them to fall inside the ocean bodies. How does plasma jet gets powered? The plasma jet gets its power by an ion thruster engines, after which it is accelerated to higher velocities by using grids or anodes.
Yes. You all will be wondering what will be the material of the machine. So the material of the machine should be at low budget as well as has the strength to bear the power and heat of the plasma. So I am recommending that the material should be mostly made up of tungsten and graphite, as they can hold the power of plasma. Remember, they are also at a very low budget.
Next is the electromagnetic machine. The electromagnetic machine is a machine which uses electricity to generate magnetic field. This magnetic field helps the machine to attract the junk. Working of the electromagnetic machine. The surface of the machine will be covered with magnets. As you all know, this magnet will be generated with the help of electricity. This machine will be attached with a sensor as well as a thruster. The thruster helps the machine to move in space as there is no gravity, and the sensor will help to detect the junk. Immediately, the magnet gets activated and it attracts the junk which is nearby and has a suitable weight. This is done because the machine will not crash itself with the junk. Now you all must be wondering, how will the machine land on the Earth? And here's your solution. The machine will be able to land on the Earth with the help of SpaceX's technology. SpaceX is a company owned and operated by Elon Musk. Elon Musk was the one who found out that fuel stages of the rocket could be brought back to Earth. Similarly, we can bring back our machine back to the Earth.
Now my friend has told what is an electromagnetic machine, how does it work, and other scientific details. Now, to make a machine, we need to know other physical details also, such as the weight of the machine, the length of the machine, and what kind of material is the machine made of. So the other features of the machine are, the weight of the machine should be 600 kgs to 700 kgs, and the length of the machine can be about 1.5 kilometers. The machine should be made of aluminium inside, and of course, there'll be an electromagnet placed outside. Now, all this making of the machine will cost some funds. So this funds is given by our budget. So this total budget, which means the total machine is estimatedly costing around 450 crores. And this 450 crores is going to be divided into three groups. And these three groups are cost of the electromagnet, cost of the body, and cost of the launching machine. Cost of the electromagnet will be approximately 200 crores. Cost of the body will be approximately 100 crores. And cost of launching the machine also requires some money, and it is 150 crores. The remaining amount will be used for other expenses.
Multitasking satellites. So, we all would have heard about the word called multitasking. Multitasking means more work than you are intended to do, and even at a given specific time. This means we are saving our time, and even it becomes easy for us to do many other work. The same can be applied to the satellites. These multitasking satellites can also be called as the multi-utility satellite. Hence, the technology here will be used effectively and even innovatively. These satellites are intended to serve more than their purpose and even for many years ahead. So, you might be curious to know, how would this idea work? So, we are going to install tiny robots into our main rocket, one of the examples of which can be given as the CubeSat. Yes, in your mind, you would get like, CubeSat, that seems like a cube robot, right? Yes. This is a robot which is literally the size of a small cube. Hence, we are referring it to as the tiny robots. So, let me give you an example. Suppose if we don't want a fuel stage of a rocket to come back to the Earth, then the main rocket will be commanded to release these CubeSats. And one more example. Suppose if our main rocket is going up in the space and detects some junk in its radar, then it will be commanded to release these CubeSats. Now, these little tiny robots will lock onto their target, and then they will revolve in an orbit around the Earth. After each lap, they will slightly increase their orbit, and after some time gradually, they will escape from this orbit into deep space. Now these tiny robots will release their junk target into deep space. As we all know, the word infinite is very less for space. Hence, we are using its own feature against itself to mitigate our space junk. As we all know that in vacuum, there is no need of any external force for an object to move further. So, if at once the force is applied, then it will move for many years ahead into deep space.
Did you know what is a CubeSat? A CubeSat is a tiny miniature satellite that is used for multitasking. Now, let's check other features of the machine. The size of the CubeSat is generally 10 into 10 into 10 centimeters. There will be maximum 40 CubeSats that will be installed in a large rocket. And minimum, there will be 15 CubeSats that will be installed in a large rocket. The weight of each this single CubeSat is approximately 1 kg. The rocket should be having enough space to launch all these CubeSats into the space. Now let's talk about the budget. The budget is very important because to make anything, we require material. And to buy material, we require budget. So let's talk about the budget now. The total budget of this multitasking satellite is approximately 147 crores. And the cost of each single CubeSat is approximately 29 lakhs. And the cost of making this large rocket, which will carry all the CubeSats, is approximately 55 crores. And the cost of launching the big rocket is approximately 80 crores.
A glimpse of what we did. Giant lasers, which shoots plasma jets in space to burn the junk. Electromagnetic machine. With the help of electricity, the machine can attract junk. Multitasking satellites. Tiny robots, CubeSats, can be sent into space, which will perform many functions of one time.
The pressure on our Earth was too much to bear, but being forced into solitude makes us stare at this new Earth we have never known, stare at the space where all of us were grown. Use this time wisely, for the time is now. Time to stand together, you all know how. With this strong thought, we would like to conclude our speech by saying, join the revolution and stop the pollution. Thank you.
Thank you, students, for such a wonderful and elaborative presentation for us. You have really exceeded our expectations, and we are really proud of you all. Honestly, we are really proud of you all. I would like to take a moment to express our gratitude to our HOD ma'am, Ms. Vedavati, for providing the students for such a wonderful opportunities. I request our HOD ma'am, Ms. Vedavati ma'am, to please say a few words.
Thank you, Deepika. I think, you know, before even I could say anything, I must thank all the students for sharing a wonderful knowledge about space pollution. We never knew that so much is there. We only knew that, you know, we launch rockets and we get to know complete information about space. But it is an eye-opener for many of us that we are also polluting space along with our Earth. Thank you so much, students. And it's a social responsibility. And I'm sure I can see many astronauts here who are ready to clear the space pollution. Right? Wonderful job. And this is what, you know, a benchmark for you to get into NASA projects, which you will be taking up in your classes. Probably 9th and 10th class students have the opportunity. So you're already there with a lot of information, and that will definitely help you out. Thank you so much, and all the very best.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request our Vinay sir to say a few words.
We can move on. I think due to technical reasons, Vinay is not around.
Okay, ma'am. Shabri sir, to say a few words.
Yeah, good evening, Deepika ma'am. Good evening, Veda ma'am, and all of you. Very wonderful presentation. As already was mentioned by Veda ma'am and all, eye-opener. First of all, when I was in 8th grade, all I knew is there is sun, moon, and, you know, the stars. Probably not even about the rockets. So it's a little embarrassing when I listen to an 8th grader explaining me what is the... And yeah, obviously, I never knew India had a fund of 13,000 crore for space research, because obviously, like, you know, recently we came to read, we could only afford 15,000 crore for the pandemic, COVID. So in that scenario, when I come to know 13,000 crore was allotted, that's a wonderful information. Very proud of our country as well. The best part of your presentation was you came out with some very funky solutions like the Jing laser, the electromagnetic mission, the multitasking satellites. Wow. Kudos. And you know, you told me that one satellite can, you were like telling me as it is a simple task, the weight can be like 600 kg and you know, it can expand up to 1.5 kilometer. I was like, no, 1.5 kilometer, like it's not 1.5 meters, but you said about 1.5 kilometers. So overall, a great information, a great insight. And yeah, obviously even I will be going back and learning a lot about the space and what happens in the space. And let's shout out loud to the governments and the agencies that, you know, dude, please don't pollute the space as well, like how we do for the Earth in several formats, which was already discussed. So very great presentation indeed. Thank you for all the wonderful research you have done and for the entire team who have supported you, which includes the SOSPL mentors, your parents, your brothers or sisters who ever helped. And finally, last but not the least, the kind of opportunity we got from our department through Vedavati Ma'am. So thanking each and everyone for this great opportunity, and also Shashank sir for coordinating this entire event. That's all. Thank you. Thank you, Deepika Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, sir. So with that, we have come to the much awaited event. So I personally know it's not only me, Sharon Ma'am, Purva Ma'am, Shabri sir, has everyone watched you. And with constant support, you are always there asking your doubts, clarifying with us, right? With lot of efforts that you have worked, it has all come, all your efforts were seen today in this event. So once again, I thank you all for being for attending this event and hoping you all had a good time presenting it. With that, we shall conclude our event. Thank you, sir. Sir, can we end it?
Yes, Veda ma'am, we are ending the session. Shashank sir, thank you so much, sir. We can end the session. Once again, all the best to and congratulations to all the students. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And thank you. Thank you,
sir.
All.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.